You must not deviate from the instruction of what God has told you to do concerning your situation. Every single situation that you're going through right now, what's happening in your life, God has spoken to you. Commitment, commitment. Commitment is the relentless determination to succeed. The relentless determination to succeed. That's what we're going to be talking about this morning. It's a mindset. And diligence is the work that goes with it. And diligence is the work that goes with it. What does the word commitment really mean? It means to pledge and to obligate oneself to a cause. It means to pledge and to obligate oneself to a cause. Things come to those who are committed. Commitment is the result of a strong will. Lack of commitment is the result of a strong won't. You hear me? Strong will brings commitment.
Right.
Strong won't is when there's a lack of commitment. Many times, this is what Thomas Edison said, many times success consists of hanging on 1 minute longer. Committed to succeed. However long that moment is, you must hang on. Is somebody hearing me? You can't let go. Easier said than done. Turn with me, if you will, this morning to Isaiah 40, verse 28.
Have you not known? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, does not faint nor grow weary. There is no searching for his understanding. He gives power to the faint and weary, and to him who has no might, he increases strength, causing it to multiply and making it to abound.
Back up, Robert, and give me that last part. He gives power to the faint. Yeah.
And to the weary. And to him who has no might, he increases strength, causing it to multiply and making it to abound.
So that means if I feel that it's hard for me to commit. There really is no excuse, because the word of God tells me that he will give me the power to commit. Is somebody grabbing that? No excuse. I'm not a committed person. Well, if you have this Jesus Christ within your heart, the resurrected one, then you've got it stored inside of you. Did you hear me over here? So commitment is part of his character, and now it becomes part of yours. Do you hear me? Next.
Even youth shall faint and be weary.
Come on.
And selected young men shall feebly stumble and fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord, who expect, look for, and hope in him, shall change and renew their strength and
Come
power.
On.
They shall lift their wings and mount up close to God as eagles.
Woo!
Mount up to the sun. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint or become tired.
Is there any excuse for you? There's none. It's already been supplied. It's already there. Well, you don't understand. I'm so frustrated. I've tried this 15 times already. Well, guess what? Suck it up and do it again. There's no excuse, Madeline. Suck it up and let's do it again. Is that what you tell your kids? You pull down the bedspread. You say you didn't make it right. Make it again. I did. Do it the way I taught you. You do it again. You say, nah, you didn't make it. That's how we train. You understand? You've got to put it in your head that you've got to continue and be committed to your cause until you get it right. And because you have this extra bonus within you, you have the race's edge. You are able to do anything that your mind sets to. You understand that, Scott? Anything. You're a businessman. You're committed. And that doesn't mean you just take every day as usual. You're always looking on the horizon for other business. I'm committed to see this business grow, because growth is part of the kingdom. We don't live in a stagnant kingdom. We live in growth. And I pray that your minds are stretched this morning to understand what you can believe for, you can have. Amen? Amen. Now, the great heroes of faith were determined, called, and committed to their distinct assignments. I'm here to tell somebody today that you have a distinct assignment. And you have coaches all around you in this church reminding you, I'm going to remind you, and I'm going to remind you, and I'm going to strive for excellence each and every time. And if you work with me, there's no pity on you. Because I believe in the gift that's inside of you. I nudge and push and remind and call and push and nudge because I believe in the God that's in you. Because the same God that's in me is in you. And that's why I know you can do it. You can't cover it. You got to push forward through it. Okay? Let's talk about Moses, a stutterer. Have you ever been around a stutterer? And the worst thing you could do is say the sentence for them. You know that. They say, could I what? You. It's an impediment. And this is who God chose through a burning bush to get his people out of Egypt. An impeded man. A man with an impediment. There's no excuse if you even have an impediment. God says, I will do it through you. Here we see he goes back and forth. He's committed. He's a committed man. He felt he was doomed on the backside of the desert because he made a terrible error and he was just moseying along with a bunch of sheep, his wife, kids, and his father-in-law. And what happens? God says, no, it's time to get into your assignment. He said, me? I can't even speak. No, I'm going to send you someone that's going to nudge and prod and speak for you. But it's you. It's your anointing. It's your assignment. And he was committed. He was committed. He said, get my people. God says, get my people out of Egypt. Get them up to the promise that I have for them. What a journey. You don't have to be a biblical scholar. You've looked through the movies of the Ten Commandments. You know exactly what happened. Each one of those plagues was horrific. But he was committed to go back. He was a human being, folks. He was not a supernatural creation. You can't tell me that in between he didn't get frustrated and aggravated and say, this is just not, is this going to work? Now, what are you going to send next? This Pharaoh, he could kill me. But he was committed to the assignment that God gave him. And we know the story. He was committed in front of a body of water with 2 million murmuring, angry, perspired, hungry, ugly people behind him. Committed to see God in the miraculous, in front of a body of water. What is coming out of your mouth? Are you committed to the purpose of God? He said, stand still today and see the salvation of the Lord. What salvation? I've got water in front of me, 2 million people behind me, and Pharaoh's chariots chasing us. Committed. Somebody say, committed. We know the story. Joshua and Caleb. Committed. Didn't happen the way they thought. Came back, they were rejected, they were laughed at, but they waited 40 years. Committed for 40 years. If you don't get rid of your headache overnight, you're frustrated in the morning, you're cranky. Why didn't God heal my headache? I still have this headache. 40 years, they were committed to what God said. That's your land, Joshua. But you got to get in there and take it. Joshua, Caleb, they held on to the assignment to get them into the promised land. Joshua, Caleb, Joshua, the walls of Jericho. It's no fable. This doesn't belong in a wonder book. This actually happened. March around those walls. 6 times silently. And the 7th time, we know the triumph came. But what happened in the 5th day when they were throwing garbage on them? They were urinating on them. They were laughing at them. And they were to be silent. What went on in Joshua's mind? this is ridiculous, Lord. Are you sure? He was a human being. You can't tell me in the back recesses of his mind he didn't say, I'm a warrior. I know how to use a sword. What am I doing? Marching around, humiliated in front of these people. But he was committed to the instruction of what God told him to do. You must not deviate from the instruction of what God has told you to do concerning your situation. Every single situation that you're going through right now, what's happening in your life, God has spoken to you. You might not like what God said to do, but God has spoken. We are spirit-filled. We know, my sheep know my voice. You just don't want to do, because some of you, it means humility. Some of you, it means I've got to do something out of my character. That's how great victories come. Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, a 90-foot statue before them, everybody else bowing, as was the law. Three teenagers said, this is not the way we live. We're not going to do it. We're not going to do it. They were committed to the God that they served. That wasn't their God. Our teenagers today, wobbling like a weeble. You know the Fisher-Price weeble? Weebles wobble, but they don't fall down. Our kids are confused. Pete and Pam have quite a job to keep our kids strong, because the hours upon hours that they spend in the high schools, and they're being contaminated with the kids that are around them. The bullies. What they're doing to these kids. A young girl takes her life last week because she'd been bullied. Oh, I think I raised my teenagers in the wrong hour. Parents, friends, grandparents, if anybody's ever bullying your kid, you don't tolerate bullying. You hear me? We don't tolerate bullying. Three teenagers said, we won't bow. What did they do? They faced a fiery furnace. This is truth. And God was with them. Now, if our young people are enveloped in the Word of God, and not only 2 hours a week that they're here, 4 hours a week if they come on Wednesday, you know, if they're enveloped, if you're doing your homework as a grandparent and as a parent, and you're instilling the Word of God, and you're keeping them ethically straight, and you're giving them integritous thoughts, and you're not compromising to anything that's going on in their environment, they'll face the furnace of their life, and they won't be burned. Hallelujah. Somebody say hallelujah. Committed. Are your kids committed? Are your kids committed to your household? The things that you've trained them? Can you absolutely beyond a shadow of a doubt know that when your kid is out there with his friends, that everything that you've taught him in the house is happening out there? Are your kids committed to your household? The Shunammite woman, we know, we've deliciously dealt with her the last couple of weeks. She was magnificently committed. She was so committed, she traveled 32 miles on a donkey because she said, if I can get to the man, my son will live again. Committed to that journey. No nonsense, mothers. No nonsense. Not with my kid, you don't. You got to talk back to that devil. That mother, that Shunammite woman, she said, my boy was a gift. I'm not giving up my gift. I'm not giving up my gift. Amen? The Syrophoenician mother, you know, she came to Jesus and she tried to get close to him, and they kept him away. And she was from the other side of the tracks. And she had a daughter who was convulsive, and she would roll around, and she was bound. And she came to him, and with stubborn faith, stubborn, how many have stubborn faith? Stubborn faith is relentless. It looks at the facts and says, that's not where I live. I live by faith. See, that's where I live. I can't live with facts around me here. I have to live with a promise that God said, do it, Lynn Bracco, and I will be with you. And that's what we're doing here. Every day is a victory. Every day I get put my foot out of the boat and I walk on water. Every day. And he's faithful to uphold me, preserve me, and sustain me. We know that Syrophoenician woman was, he was so impressed with her because he said, I don't give my, and sometimes insulting. You get insulted sometimes. He insulted and says, this bread isn't for the dogs. It was an ethnic slur. And what she said, yeah, but even a crumb. He said, wow, lady, crumb, your kid's whole. Come on, she's made whole. Why would Jesus say? Because he was squeezing to get that out of her. You understand? Sometimes you're squeezed. The olive is squeezed so that the oil comes out. Olive oil. The oil of the anointing. She was squeezed to respond. When you're squeezed, what's your response? God has let me down. This don't work. He didn't hear me. Look. What's your response? Her response is, even one of your crumbs, sir. Paul, stoned. Paul, the murderer, the transformed man of God. Professionally stoned. Dead. Dragged him out of town. Put him on a pile. Buried him with rocks. Dead. But the disciple saw his pinky moving on his toe. Paul, get these stones off me. Paul, is that you? You're alive? They started to dig him out. Dig him out. Lifted him up. He said, let's go to the next town, guys. We're running out of time. You hear me? Is that commitment? Is that commitment? Dead, stoned, bleeding, buried. But the assignment said, you must make your way to Derby. You've got to get to the next town. You've got to make your way past Jana. You got to go to Fort Myers. Sounds ridiculous, sounds crazy, but there's a woman down there that needs help. Prophet, come in, blow the doors off this place. Prophetically speak the destiny of this church into being, and we're seeing it happen. The atmosphere is changing in Fort Myers because the obedience of a woman just says, I've got to get to Fort Myers. Paul had to get to Derby, got up, was committed for the sake of the gospel. You know why? Because one day on the road to Damascus, he was knocked off his high horse, had an encounter with Jesus Christ that he could never forget again. Have you forgotten your encounter with Jesus Christ? Do you remember the day that he set you free? Do you remember the day that he lifted your depression? Remember the day that he opened the chains, he opened the doors and let you go free? You can't forget that. That's where your story began, and that's where your story has to continue. Then my precious, precious Jesus, my Jesus, you can say my Jesus. In the garden, he went to pray when it seemed all was done. He knelt, he groomed the men for 3 years. But in that garden, he heard the drums in his head. It was time. It was time, Father, it's time. In his humanness, he said, if there's any way, no, I'm coming. went to the disciples and said, hey guys, you think you can sit with me a while? Because you know what I told you. Oh yeah, okay, all right. See, they couldn't be committed to him. They didn't understand the whole thing. They weren't committed back then. They failed him in the garden. But when the Holy Ghost came on them, when they were filled with the power of the Holy Ghost, that same guy, Peter, that denied him, stood up and 3,000 souls were saved. How many are filled with the Holy Ghost? How many are filled with the Holy Ghost? There is no excuse for you. You can't fall asleep on the job. You are committed. Say, I'm committed. You see, that's the difference. In the garden, they slept. But when the Holy Ghost, he said, I've got to go. But one is coming that will be within you. Once they were filled with the Holy Ghost, they were more than conquerors. Are you hearing me? The commitment of Jesus Christ with his own execution instrument on his back. He was committed. He was in the Via Dolorosa, walking down there, being spit at, bruises in his back. But he saw Golgotha's hill. And he says, I'm committed to get there. Because one day, Lynn Bracco is going to need me. I'm committed to her purpose. He's committed to your purpose. He's committed to your purpose. He's committed to your purpose. Whoa, my goodness, my goodness, my goodness. Understand that. You cannot back off and do it your way, because Jesus Christ was committed to your destiny, your assignment, and your purpose. Is somebody hearing me? It's a deal.